I'm very sad, but at the same time pleased to announce the last talk of this conference. Also, our second keynote speaker, Hong Yu Wang. Hong Yu is a professor of philosophy and also the leader of neuroscience research group at the Werner Reichardt Center of Integrative Neuroscience at the University of Tübingen, which is a DMG excellent cluster in Tübingen. Moreover, he's also a faculty member of the Max Planck Neural and Behavioral Graduate School. He specializes mostly in the philosophy of mind and cognitive neuroscience. His papers include emergence from fusion, Cartesian psychophysics, personal and subpersonal overcoming explanatory apartheid. That's my favorite title. In and out of balance, and the puzzle about the function of proprioception in action, and many, many more papers. Moreover, he has a book forthcoming in the Oxford University Press titled Embodied Agency. I'm very delighted to have over Hong Yu and give a talk to us on embodiment.
Thank you, David. I want to begin by thanking our organizers, David and Rina, and let's give them a round of applause.
Big thanks to Simon.
Simon, yes. Yes.
And thank you, Simon, for making it. And to the university for finding this wonderful occasion. So today I'm going to talk about embodiment. And these are some new thoughts which are occasioned by David's invitation here. So this is, I think, the last chapter of my book, where I try to bring together some thoughts on embodiment, on agency, and what implications this has for the self, both giving a constitutive account of the self and also metaphysics of the self and what the relations are between them. But I'm primarily a philosopher of perception and action, so I will be conservative about the metaphysics and try to remain as much out of the firing range as possible. So here's my agenda for today. I'm going to start by talking about various questions about embodiment. I think there are very many different questions on embodiment. I'm going to focus on several in particular. And I'm going to try to develop a line of embodiment, a line on embodiment, which has been, I think, very influential in the literature. Very few people have discussed it. I think Eric has written on it a little bit in the more recent book. So this is Sidney Shoemaker and John Foster's account of embodiment, a functional account of embodiment. And I'm going to criticize this based on looking at how they fail to capture certain kinds of epistemic and phenomenological connections between being able to act with your body and being able to sense it from the inside. So I think there are distinctive connections we have with our body, which makes these things possible. Whereas the functional account of embodiment that we get from Shoemaker and Foster has to specify connections with the body, and connections with the body in action, and connections with the body in perception, independently, so that they coincide. But I think that's not possible. And I'm going to get that from looking at the phenomenology of embodiment. Now, even though I think the account, as it stands, doesn't work, I think it contains the core of a very interesting possibility for articulating a constitutive account of embodiment, which is given in functional terms. And in order to extend their project, I'm going to give a non-reductive version of their functional account, but try to specify other capacities which are involved, not just perception and action. And I will get that by looking at different cases of pathologies of embodiment. So I'll look at varieties of disembodiment. And on the other hand, recent empirical work has allowed us to see various possibilities for artificial embodiment. And I'm going to look at various possibilities from artificial embodiment. And with these, then we shall extend the functional account in a non-reductive way, such that we have the beginnings of an attempt at a constitutive account of embodiment. So far, I will have remained outside of the firing range of our distinguished metaphysicians in the audience. Now, in the final part, I will walk into the firing range, to be shot at, So what I'll do there is a little bit of fun. I'm going to sketch out six different metaphysical models of embodiment and ask how the constitutive account connects with these different constitutive metaphysical models of embodiment. So that's the picture. Okay, what's embodiment? It's one of these words that is so trendy, one of these keywords, you put it in all your grants to get money and so on and so forth. And sometimes you think, well, you hear about it and it's really meaningless. It's one of these fashionable terms of art in cognitive science, and in a way you say, well, we've got to be embodied. But substance dualists also say we have to be embodied, so what's the big deal? It's used to mean very many things. There is this very important review paper from Margaret Wilson where she specifies six different meanings of embodied cognition. So the six are situatedness, time-pressuredness of cognition, offloading various processes onto the environment, some form of externalism in terms of environmental input, the idea that cognition is for action, and the idea that offline cognition is body-based. So these are the main notions of embodiment in the sort of cognitive, scientific, and philosophical literature. But the notion of embodiment I'm going to talk about is none of these, okay? It's a much more traditional notion of embodiment. A notion of embodiment that we have been concerned with since the dawn of mankind and which Aristotle wrote about. You are a rational animal, you have the capacity for movement of a body. Okay. So one question here, if we want to focus on this more traditional conception of embodiment, of embodied agency, is whether embodiment only arises for Cartesian dualists. So you might think, well, if you think you're a soul, you have to be attached to your body in some way so that you can, you know, do things, see people, meet your friends, and hang out, and so on and so forth. Now, if we're no longer dualists, maybe this question just doesn't arise anymore. But I think that's not the case. I mean, there's a sense of the question whether one has a body that arises even if one is not a Cartesian dualist. So what is the sense of this question of having a body? And in particular, if we are some form of physicalist or animalist, how can we raise the question of whether we have a body if you are in some sense your body? Okay. So the primary research question I want to pose here is, how does a subject relate to its body? And this question arises in a way we can see the question of relating to one's body arises because there are various pathological instances of relating to one's body. So in a pathology that I will later talk about, which often comes from right hemisphere strokes, this is a pathology called somatoparaphrenia. In somatoparaphrenia, the patients have a vision of a limb which is affected by stroke, and often they disown the limb. They say that the limb is not theirs. Okay? It's clearly connected to them, it's biologically part of their body, but they deny that the limb belongs to them. Okay? So this is in a way a pathology of relating to one's body. So if there are such cases, such pathologies, then there's a question about how we relate to the body, how we relate to one's body, such that it belongs to one. Now, given this primary research question, I think there are four major ways that this can be attacked and answered, and these four different ways of posing the question have often been run together in the literature on this topic. So the first question is a phenomenological one. What is it like to have a body? Okay? What is it like to be embodied? That's the first question. The second question is a constitutive question. What is it to be embodied? What is the nature of embodiment? The third question is a causal question, causal mechanical question. And this is the main question that scientists have been looking at in recent years with, for example, the rubber hand illusion and different other kinds of empirical forms of artificial embodiment. And here they have been looking at various mechanisms underlying these structures of embodiment. And here the question is, what are the causal structures underlying embodiment? What brings about embodiment? Under what conditions can you induce embodiment? Finally, a fourth question, which is incredibly important, but which we have no scientific grasp on, and philosophically, remains very elusive is a functional question. What is the function of embodiment? What is the point of having a body in this sense? Okay, so there are these four questions. Today I'll primarily concentrate on trying to give a constitutive account in the light of the phenomenology of embodiment and embodied agency, and connecting it perhaps to some functional considerations. So our question is, how does a subject relate to its body? And I think the most influential philosophical account so far, well, can't be said to be very influential because very few people have written on it, but the most significant philosophical account so far is the account from Shoemaker and Foster. It's in Foster's book, The Immaterial Self, and in Shoemaker it's in a couple of papers, but the most important paper is this one called Embodiment and Behavior, where he's discussing connections between other minds and the ascription of mental states. The account is very simple, remarkably simple, and there are two components. The basic idea is a subject, for example, if we look at the case of action, is agentially embodied in a certain body to the extent that she can intentionally act with that body. It's very, very simple and intuitive. So a subject is agentially embodied in a certain body to the extent that she can intentionally act with that body. It's the action component. And the perception side is this. The subject is perceptually embodied in a certain body to the extent that interactions of that body with its surroundings result in her having veridical experiences of the surroundings. Okay? So this is the perception side. Now if you're a disjunctivist or representationalist, you can read the veridical experiences clause in different ways. So if you're a disjunctivist, you'll say you have experiences which are not illusory and not hallucinatory. If you're a representationalist, you can do it in terms of a classical causal theory of perception. But the idea is very simple, you can see. You are embodied in a certain body to the extent that you can act with it and you can perceive with it appropriately. Okay? And this relation is a kind of graded relation, such that you are embodied in something to the extent to which you can act with it or perceive with it. And you can see how this can cope with different kinds of deprivations and different kinds of pathologies of embodiment. It's important to realize that the specification of the agency clause and the experience clause here in terms of which body is the one that one is agentially embodied in and which one is experientially embodied in is independent, okay? And it will come as a result that you have one single body that you are agentially and experientially embodied in, okay? So these are the two conditions. And Shoemaker then says that these two criteria are the primary criteria of embodiment simpliciter, okay? Now, it's important to realize that there's a commitment to this notion of embodiment being purely functional and that the conditions are independent. So Foster is very clear about this. He says, the connection between the subject and the biological organism is fundamentally a functional one. It's a matter of there being a psychophysical arrangement whereby each partner is equipped to have the right sorts of direct causal influence on each other. And that's all it is to have embodiment in a particular body. Okay? So that's, so far we have the Shoemaker-Foster account. And they also note, in particular Foster, that when you have this kind of embodiment, the paradigmatic case of this will generate distinctive kinds of experiences. Namely, at certain points, such appropriateness helps to promote a feeling of embodiment in the subject. Himself, it helps to make it seem to the subject experientially as if he and the organism are one. Okay? So this is a phenomenological remark, an observation, but it's extraneous to the constitutive account of the theory as so far provided. In fact, as a substance dualist, Foster is committed to this being a kind of illusorical feeling as such. Okay, so now we have the Shoemaker-Foster account of embodiment, and I want to ask whether it can really capture the phenomenology of embodiment as we experience it in our everyday lives, in ordinary agency, in ordinary life, in the kinds of life that our narrative theories were talking about, the kinds of everyday experiences. Okay, so what's the phenomenology of embodiment? Well, it's remarkably hard to say, actually. It's something that we are constantly experiencing, but remarkably hard to say. The irony of it is that I think Descartes provided perhaps the best description of what's distinctive about embodiment. And this comes in the sixth meditation, in the very famous passage that all of us are very familiar with. Nature also teaches me by these sensations of pain, hunger, thirst, and so on, that I am not merely present in my body as a sailor is present in a ship, but that I am very closely joined and, as it were, intermingled with it, so that I and the body form a unit. So in other words, being embodied in one's body, one gets distinctive signals such that non-inferentially one makes judgments that, you know, one is hungry and so on and so forth. So the way one feels hungry is not like a pilot knowing that the ship is out of fuel. There's not a gauge, so as it were, which blinks, and then one then has to check it and, you know, fill up the fuel tank as well. You directly feel these feelings of hunger. The same is true of agency with one's body, even though Descartes' remark is just about sensation. When you're acting with your body, you're not acting with it in a way by acting with first doing something else. You can directly strive with your body. So a pilot in a ship would have to operate the ship by pressing some buttons, resulting in some movements and so on and so forth. Rather, you can directly strive with your body. So it's not like a pilot in a ship, okay? So the phenomenology of embodiment is not like being like a pilot in a ship. Okay, good. So summary. Now, what is the implication if we take this to really characterize the central observation about what it's like to be embodied? Well, for one, the kind of relation between oneself and one's body is not just this causal functional relation that we find in the Shoemaker-Foster account. In particular, in the Shoemaker-Foster account, remember, the perception clause was formulated just about environmental perception, such that you would have very little experiences of the environment, such that you are having those experiences in an appropriate way given the stimulus. Now, I think what this kind of phenomenology shows is that the agency and the perception conditions in normal, healthy human agents, at least, should not be seen as separate conditions which can be independently applied. Because there's a distinctive way you can act with your body, because that is the body that you can feel from the inside. Okay? You act with your body in this distinctive way because you can feel it from the inside. I won't go into this account specifically here because it's one third of my book, but I've argued that because we have a distinctive mode of access to our bodies from the inside, this kind of proprioceptive or interoceptive access, this constrains, you know, in a way, the grasp of one's action possibilities that we have for normal healthy agents. And because of that, the very way that we strive with our body is constrained by the grasp of the body that we have, which means that the action and perception conditions cannot be independently specified in the way that Shoemaker and Foster require. Rather, if you are able to specify these conditions in a separate way, then you would need something like a telekinetic account of action. Action is simply unconstrained by the kind of body that you can have. In principle, if I could move this cup directly, it would be part of my body, for example. Now, ordinary agency is not like that. We are always directly acting with our body first before we act with other things. Okay, I can talk about this more, but the idea here generally is that these conditions are intertwined in a way that we can't specify them separately. So we need to give a kind of account of embodiment that is simultaneously richer and also non-reductive. We need to give an account which is richer because the action and perception conditions doesn't exhaust what characterizes normal, healthy embodiment. We can already see that in the perception case, because in the perception clause, as stated by Shoemaker and Foster, It's only concerning the external environment. But one of the major things about the phenomenology of embodiment is that one feels one's body from the inside. And this fails to be captured in the account. So now in an attempt to build up an account, I'm going to look at different varieties of disembodiment to look at what the good case should look like. So one of the difficulties in giving an account of embodiment is that we are all healthily embodied and living with our bodies every day in such a way that the body is never absent. Okay? In a way, because it's never absent, it's also never present in the foreground of attention, unless you're having a pain or some very pleasurable sensation or some other very weird sensation. But even when you have specific sensations and attend to them, you don't attend to the large-scale structure of your embodiment in particular. So in order to tease it out, one good way is to look at different ways in which embodiment can go wrong. Okay, we can call this the clinical approach to embodiment. And here we have a neurologist and a neuropsychologist. And the idea is that through breakdowns in function, we can infer what normal function is, and hence arrive at a picture of normal paradigm embodiment. I'm not going to be able to go through all the possible pathologies of embodiment, but I will go through some of the major ones. So the first one I've already talked about, it's the pathology of somatoparaphrenia, where you have denial of ownership of a part of one's body. So here's a patient who describes her hand as belonging to her husband. Okay? So in order to illustrate the episode, here's a little kind of interview between a neurologist and a patient. So E stands for experimental, P is patient. The experimenter says, close your eyes and tell me what you feel when I'm touching your hand. Patient, that's not my hand. It's not mine. Someone left it there. I don't know who he was. I don't know who attached it to my body. Okay. This is in a situation like that. Okay. Now, experimenter then says, isn't it a little bit weird to have a foreign hand with you? Mm. Patient, no, my hand is not like that. Okay. So you can see that this is a very weird and unusual scenario where you deny that a certain body part, which is clearly very much connected to you, belongs to you. Okay, so this is a form of disembodiment. Okay. Now, that is a case where you have this ownership of one specific body part. Recent neurology has returned to uncover a series of cases of various out-of-body phenomena. So these are called otoscopic phenomena, where patients feel that they are not present in their body. So in these cases, these are usually neurological patients. And let's look at these two. One is the so-called out-of-body experience. So the dotted one indicates the experience phenomenology, and the arrow indicates the direction of the first-person perspective that the subject reports him or herself as having. So in this case, the subject is actually lying on a bed, but when he or she is having an out-of-body experience, he or she experiences themselves as looking down at their biological body. So here you have the pathology both of self-location, and often this is accompanied also with issues to do with body ownership. So there are certain parts of your body that they disown. Okay. So this is out-of-body experience. Another radical one, which is quite similar, is what's called otoscopy. And in these cases, patients feel that they can see themselves. They have a body double, and they experience themselves being in a different location and looking back at their biological body. And often they report that they feel that they are either switching between the biological and the illusory body double, or bilocated in both cases. And they often also have disorders of embodiment, so they feel that the body is alien. Okay. So you see that these are very, very striking disorders where you don't feel that you inhabit your body in some way, and you don't feel you are located where your body is. It's very striking. Okay. Now, so far I've been talking primarily about spatial cases which may have some affect involved as well. So both the idea of disowning certain body parts, disowning the whole body, and all this idea of mislocation of one's body. Now I'm going to talk about more affective kinds of disorders. So this is what's called depersonalization or derealization disorder. And this disorder is not very well understood, but it seems to be connected in some cases with vestibular disorders. And the usual way to test for this disorder is to use what's called the Cox and Swinson inventory, containing a number of items. And I've highlighted a number of items in order to bring up aspects of this pathology. So patients often report that their body feels strange or alien in some way. This is not to disown the body, but it just feels odd, this feeling of oddity. They also have this sense of feeling of detachment or separation from the surroundings. They have a numbing of emotions generally. They feel detached, separated from their body. They feel like a spectator. Now, and they, maybe you can't see this at below. This is often accompanied with correlative kind of alienation from the world. They feel that they are isolated from the world, that they lack this sense of reality or connectedness to the world. And they feel spaced out in some way. Now, this disorder, depersonalization and derealization disorder, is often interpreted as an affective disorder. These patients are not having the appropriate kinds of affect that they tend to expect from the history of experience of interacting in normal life. So they're looking at a scene, or they're sort of feeling their body from the inside in normal circumstances. And after they have this disorder, they don't get the correct kind of affect that they're used to getting. And then they feel that they are depersonalized in some way, or they feel the world is unreal. So this is an affective disorder of ownership. Affective disorder of embodiment. Finally, and most striking, is Cotard syndrome, which is in a way very close in its interpretation to the derealization and depersonalization disorders. It involves a number of different elements. First of all, there are desomatization delusions, where they feel that they can't really feel their body. Their body feels anesthetized in some way. The body feels numb. And then they have dementalization delusions. So here's a quote from a patient. The patient says, "If I had a brain, I would think, but I don't think." Okay. And finally, and most striking, we have death and non-existence delusions. So here's another quote from a patient from original notes of Cotard and co-workers in the 19th century. "You know that we have drowned. It's not me who's talking to you. You are talking to yourself in me. I'm not anything anymore. I don't exist." Okay, very spooky. Now, in these cases, this pathology is also interpreted as an affective disorder. Basically, these patients lack the kind of affect that we have in normal life in inhabiting our body. And they interpret this kind of lack of affect as their non-existence in a way. So you have two components in this disorder. You have a kind of you have a kind of weird experience, this lack of affect. Okay? And on the second hand, on the other hand, you have a kind of robust, weird rationalization. Okay? They persist in rationalizing the weird kind of experience as involving death or non-existence or lacking a mind, lacking a body, and so on and so forth. So you have this kind of two-factor account of delusions. Weird experience, robust, weird rationalization. Okay, so now we have a basic catalog of the different kinds of disorders of embodiment, and we can try to put it together so that we have an indication of the major lines of inquiry that we need to look at, so that we can specify different conditions of embodiment other than just external perception and agency. So here's a chart. Okay, let's begin with perception. So we didn't talk about any perceptual deficit so far, but a very simple perceptual deficit of embodiment would be things like blindness, deafness, and so on and so forth. So these are different ways of being perceptually disembodied. Okay, and so that the deficit is one of perception. And at a higher level, you have different kinds of agnosognosia. So these are diseases where people don't acknowledge a certain deficit that they have. So one example of this is Anton syndrome. These are people who are actually blind, but they say that they're not blind. Okay? So these are people who lack awareness of a very striking perceptual deficit. Okay? Can you imagine someone not realizing that they're blind? It's very striking. Okay, so here you have a deficit of awareness of perceptual abilities. So those are two examples of the perceptual aspect of embodiment. If we look at agency, the simplest case is that of paralysis or losing function in a certain kind of limb or finger and so on and so forth. So you have different degrees of this. And similarly to the perceptual case, you also have various agnosognosias. So one example after stroke injuries is often what's called agnosognosia for hemiplegia. So people are paralyzed or partially paralyzed, and they don't realize that they can no longer move. Or they don't realize that they can no longer move some paralyzed body parts. Because here you have an awareness of agency. So usually the standard clinical test is that the experimenter asks the patient to clap their hands. Okay? And so they're instructed to clap their hands. And what happens is the patient does this. And then the experimenter asks, well, have you, tell me when you're done clapping. And then they say, oh, I've clapped my hands. So in that case, you have all the feedback that you normally have, but they don't realize that they can't move their hand. Okay? Very striking. So another case is that of delusions of influence and control in schizophrenia. Some people think that other people are controlling their thoughts or movements and so on and so forth. Or they think that they have the ability to control the thoughts and movements of other people. So once again, you have a deficit of the awareness of agency and agentive abilities. So far we have looked at cases of perception and agency. Next we turn to cases of affect. So we looked at two affective disorders of embodiment just now, depersonalization and derealization, and on the other hand, Cotard syndrome. So in depersonalization, derealization, we have this deficit of the feeling of reality, or in other words, what you have is a feeling of unreality and also this feeling of alienation. In Cotard syndrome, you have a feeling of non-existence or having died or something like that. So you can see that these are central aspects of normal embodiment if they can go wrong in this way. Now it's important to realize also that you can have combinations of different aspects coming together in certain syndromes. So the disorder of somatoparaphrenia is a disorder of body ownership. So they feel that some part of their body does not belong to them. And nowadays, this is interpreted as involving typically a spatial component involving some kind of deficit of perception. Usually, there's a problem with touch and somatosensation and proprioception generally. And also, there is an issue with affect. They feel that the hand is alien in some way to them. They have this charged negativity to the hand. Okay, so it's in a way a mixed case. And there's another case which David mentioned during his talk, that's of body identity integrity disorder. It currently is being investigated very heavily, and it has many different names. So another name is xenomelia or apotemnophilia, which means, apotemnophilia means the love of amputation. Okay? Now, these people, it's very hard to interpret because neurologically, it's not clear at all that there's a certain kind of unity. And some cases might be psychoanalytically determined as forms of paraphilia. Some other cases are more neurological because they involve also very, very clear objective measures, like, for example, a reduced skin conductance response when the limb is threatened, for example. So generally here they have a deficit of ownership and a kind of feeling of integrity of the body. Okay? But notice that this disorder involved different aspects of embodiment. It probably involves some kind of issues with perception possibly issues with agency as well, certainly affective issues, and potentially also cognitive issues to do with problems with judgment. So you have a kind of mixed bag. Now, once we have this, then we can take these conditions and try to write up what is a good case. Okay? So besides the case of pathologies, we also need to look at artificial embodiment. Because that's the other side. There are the pathologies, there's also the extensions. Okay? Deprivations, extensions. So now let's look at cases of artificial embodiment. So here are six central examples. So the first is a hand transplant. You can have limb transplants of different sorts. So now there's such technology such that if one loses a body part, you might be able to find a donor after some time. And if you have immunosuppressive drugs, you are able to learn how to use the hand, and the body doesn't reject the hand, then you can begin to embody the hand after a while. So this is a hand transplant. Second case is that of prosthesis. So you can have a leg prosthesis or a hand prosthesis, which you can incorporate into your body schema and learn to use, in which case you can walk again, for example. The third case is that of, which is very familiar to us, that of tool use. When you use a tool, in a way you're extending your agentive capacities. Sometimes you might also be extending your perceptual capacities. Because, for example, anecdotally, there's always this story about the blind man using the cane to tap around. And the blind man is both using the cane to navigate and also to perceive, because blind man perceives the taps on the edge of the stick as if they were part of his body. And he's also using the stick to act. Okay, so there's two use. The fourth case is that of embodying an avatar. I think Lucas has mentioned this kind of thing a couple times. So all of you have heard about, you know, Oculus Rift and Facebook investing in Oculus Rift. Probably if you go to your local electronics shop, you can buy a VR headset for about €1,000 and play lots of very fun games with it involving, you know, controlling an avatar. In these cases, when you have control, you seem to feel yourself present there. Okay, this is also the case for certain kinds of virtual teleportation devices. So for example, Lucas was mentioning the case of the drone pilots, okay, or teleoperation generally. Now the fifth case is a recent addition to psychology. It's called the rubber hand illusion. How many of you have heard of it? Okay, fair number. Now in this rubber hand illusion, which is a fantastic Halloween party trick, I highly recommend it for Halloween, and kids love it. Kids are. We had a party, and one of my postdocs brought her children along, and they just kept doing this. So it's very eerie. Now, what happens in the rubber hand illusion is that under certain conditions of stimulation, you can feel that you own a hand that you clearly know doesn't belong to you. This rubber hand. Okay. The same kind of paradigm can be extended to foot avatars. Okay, so you can see your back, and if you have synchronous stroking, you can feel that you are embodied there where you see yourself to be. Okay, so these are different possibilities for artificial embodiment. So I'll go through each of these cases briefly. So the tool use case, there's quite hard physiological evidence that we have an extension of what's called the body schema. So the body schema is a kind of subpersonal representation that we use to codify parts of our body and its positions and how it's moving so that you can control your action. Now, in single cell recordings done on monkeys, they see that there's an expansion of the receptive field from before to after tool use. So these bimodal neurons, which are normally covering just the hand, which are just encoding the hand, have expanded after tool use to incorporate the tool. So this is quite hardcore perceptual evidence that you have an extension of your body in tool use. Okay, so now we have the rubber hand illusion. This is how it's done. Okay, so you have synchronous stimulation, and gradually the subject will feel a sense of ownership. the threat is to indicate that in cases where you feel a sense of ownership of the limb, you can look at the difference between the stimulation condition, synchronous condition, and the asynchronous condition, where you don't generate a sense of ownership, and you don't have the same kind of response to the rubber hand being threatened, which marks objectively the idea that you have a certain kind of representation of the rubber hand as in some way belonging to your body. Because this is despite your believing that it is a rubber hand and not part of your body. So you have a belief-independent illusion here. Now, what happens when you do the rubber hand illusion properly, not in that kind of scenario, is that you also have a questionnaire which you fill, and this is correlated with various objective measures of embodiment, such as the threat response and the proprioceptive drift. And the key item is that you have this item saying, I felt as if the rubber hand were my hand, and you can see that subjects agree with that statement. Okay? Similarly, the same kind of idea can be applied to embodying the entire body. And this has been used as a paradigm to study some of those neurological issues that I talked about just now, this autoscopic phenomena, where you have out-of-body experiences. So there are two versions of this. I'll just talk about this version. So the idea is just the same as the rubber hand, basically. You have video feedback here of your back. And in the video feedback, what you see is yourself sort of quite a bit in front of your actual physical position. And there are two conditions, there's synchronous and asynchronous stimulation. Simultaneously stroking this here, and you see the stroking that in the VR headset. And when the stroking is synchronous, then by various measures you have a proprioceptive drift toward this location, and you also feel a sense of embodiment over this full body avatar. So there's a sense in which you have kind of you have shifted in self-location, even though you have not moved at all. Okay? This is very striking. It's very striking cases. Now, all these different illusions are of course based on subpersonal structures, which ensure that these extensions are possible. I won't talk about them in detail, but the idea is that there are such details which enable us to explain the glimmers of how these kinds of extensions are possible. Okay? So given the pathological aspects and also the aspects where we have extensions, the deprivations and extensions, we're now in a position to try to put together a better functional account of embodiment. So we begin with the conditions that we inherit from Shoemaker and Foster, namely the condition for agential embodiment and also that for perceptual embodiment. I think the affective disorders, such as depersonalization, derealization, and also Cotard syndrome, and also aspects of somatoparaphrenia, very clearly show that a very important aspect of embodiment is emotional. It's affective. So we add a different, a next condition about affect, that you have to be in a way emotionally, affectively embodied in your body. So a subject is effectively embodied in a certain body to the extent that effective mental states are reflected in bodily changes, and bodily changes are experienced. Okay. Now further conditions would be a proprioceptive condition and also an ownership condition. So we talked about proprioception. When you have proprioception, I think Christina talked about proprioception. Proprioception is the kind of awareness of the position and the movement of your body parts from the inside without looking or touching. So we have receptors in the muscle spindles and also in the joints that allow you to sense changes in joint angles. And what these allow you to do is to sense the position of your body and also movement without looking at your body at all. And in these cases, you can say that a subject is proprioceptively embodied in a certain body to the extent that she has veridical experiences of her body and its states and its position and movement from the inside. Another related condition is what's called interoception, which is something that people have only discussed very recently. It's actually something that Sherrington already in the first discussion of proprioception in modern physiology already noted. So he noted that, that proprioception and interoception involve different pathways. Now, what is interoception? Interoception is not introspection. Interoception is this kind of awareness from the inside of various kinds of visceral autonomic states. So for example, the rate of your heart beating, feeling, for example, that you need to go to the loo, for example, you need to go, that's another thing, that you're hungry and so on. So these are different senses of interoception. Okay? So you can also add an interoceptive condition, because this isn't necessarily just about the position and movement of body parts. And finally, we saw from the disorders of full body and body part disownership that there will be an important condition on ownership as well. And that will be that a subject inhabits a certain body to the extent that she has a sense of ownership over that body. Now, to summarize then, we have these five conditions. This will represent, I don't think this is exhaustive of all the conditions that one actually needs on a full constitutive account of embodiment, but that this covers a lot of the main bases. So we have agential embodiment, perceptual embodiment, affective embodiment, proprioceptive embodiment, and the way we own and inhabit our body. When these conditions come together, then we can say that one is one of these subjects who enjoys paradigm embodiment. Okay, so that's the account. This is just a specific specification. Okay, now I've given an extension of the functional account of embodiment. Now I have two questions. What's the connection between the functional account and the phenomenology of embodiment? So notice that the functional account has specified these different aspects, but has already connected some of the phenomenology into the account, in a way such that the specification of these conditions cannot be understood independently in the way Shoemaker and Foster required. So for example, the ownership condition has no way of being specified independently of experiencing the body from the inside as one's own. And the ownership condition plausibly also sets different constraints on agential embodiment, because we can see also from other kinds of disorders that disorders of the sense of embodiment, sense of ownership of one's body, also connect with disorders about the sense of agency over one's body. This is very plausible, because why would you act with a body that you don't own? Right? If you feel that a certain body part, it doesn't belong to the body, why should you plan or move with it? There's no rational reason why. So these conditions are going to be intertwined in a way that independent specification of the object, that is the object that specifies these conditions, will not be possible. So what we have in a way is a non-reductive constitutive account, constitutive sketch of an account of embodiment, which already involves a phenomenological aspect as part of its specification. Second question, which is what the metaphysicians have been waiting for the last 40 minutes, is how does a constitutive account connect to the metaphysics of embodiment? Okay, so by constitutive account, I mean giving an account which is the nature of embodiment. So you might ask, why isn't a constitutive account a metaphysical account of embodiment too? In a way it is, but I think that the history of philosophy has given us many different metaphysical accounts of embodiment that in their own way are constitutive accounts of embodiment. But my question here is, how does our functional account of embodiment, the one that I've just sketched, connect with different metaphysics of embodiment? And I'm going to present you now with six different metaphysical models of embodiment. Okay, six. Okay, so there's a minimal model, a Cartesian model, a brain-in-the-vat model, a no-ownership model, a lock-in model, and a hylomorphic model. No doubt there will be more models, but that will be enough for my purposes. So the minimal model is really minimal. Okay, I'm using the smiley emoticon to denote a kind of self-like picture. It's like a mind. Okay. So on the minimal model, the idea is that a kind of mental subject, a subject will have some physical properties. So this container, this blue container, denotes stands for there being some physical properties. Okay. It's very, very, very minimal. So given that the minimal model is a model, you see that the different models need not exclude each other necessarily. Okay, so this is the first model. The second model is a model that has been covered by some of the discussions on narrativity. So I think in a way, Dennett's model is a no-ownership model, because the narrative self, in a way, is a kind of illusion of sorts, which is sort of created by the brain. So this is what all the social psychologists on the East Coast of the United States of America say. There's there no selves, it's just a grand illusion, it's a myth. It's the myth, the kingpin of all myths, the idea that they are selves. Rather, it's just, you know, bodies with thoughts connected to them, and then somehow the brain generates this illusion of there being a self. So here we have, this view is not old, not new. It's not unique to the East Coast of the US of A. Now, this was the most popular view of the self of the Vienna Circle as well. So Schlick and Hempel and people like that had this view. And it's discussed in chapter 2 of Strawson's Individuals, in the famous chapter on persons. It's called the no-ownership view. The idea is that there is no owner of these various states. So it's, in a way, a physical version of Hume's view. So what you have is causal connections. You have various thoughts and sensations, mental entities connected down to a body. So they have causal connections. That causal connection being tied up to the body just is the relation of embodiment in this case. And when you have the proper kinds of causal connectedness down to a body here, the brain squirts out an illusion of the self that generates narratives about itself. And does philosophy and things like that. All that is an illusion. There are no selves. Okay, so this is the most minimal, the most radical. The most classical is the Cartesian model. Here you have a kind of a smiley emoticon. It's purple because we don't quite know what it is. It's a mental substance. We know not what it is. So it's a soul or mind. And embodiment, so in a way, this is the most classical picture of embodiment. You have a mental substance, and it's in some way closely conjoined with the body, such that once you have that together, you have substantial union, and they come together to be the human person. Okay? So this is the Cartesian model. Now, since then, philosophy has developed new technological devices, the most impressive of which is the brain in a vat. It's a piece of technology. It's a piece of technology that costs you no money, and yet can do anything. So it's fantastic. It's precisely the kind of device that philosophers are paid to invent. Now, what happens when you have a brain in a vat? So you have a brain, and it's in a vat. And it's very clever. So it gets rigged up with, you know, the best minds of the century, so that you continue to experience life as if you had a body. Okay, so now it involves computers, and you might be a brain in a vat thinking thoughts about brains in vats. Okay, so the architecture here would be like the kind of uploading picture. So embodiment is just having the correct kinds of transactions. In a way, once you have a physical base of sorts, just having the correct kinds of transactions which produce appearances of the external world and the one. That's what it takes to be embodied in this picture. Now, the thing is, you might think, well, this is the kind of fantastical science fiction story. But if you think in a different way, you can see that perhaps you might think that we are brains in vats as well. We, in our normal state, not in our technologically changed state. So observe that you are that, I mean, sorry. Okay. You have a vat, namely a vat of bone and skin and sinew and all these things, and your brain is in it. Okay. So in a way, we are walking brains in vats. Right? It's an observation that Searle made in the 80s. We effectively are brains in vats. And a lot of the kinds of brain transplantation, kinds of intuitions that people press on, effectively press on the thought that the model embodiment is basically that of, you know, putting a brain into a vat. Okay, so that's a picture of embodiment. And when you put the brain into another vat, namely you have a body transplant or something like that, the person goes with it and you get a new body. Okay, so that's a different model. Another picture, which I'm not sure really is a picture of embodiment, is concerns that of coincident objects. So you have persons, and then you have the animal, which is where the person is, or its body. And in these cases, there will be some kind of relation such that the person has the animal or has the body, and that will be understood to be a way of characterizing or cashing out what it means for the person to be embodied. Okay. Finally, we have from Aristotle, perhaps a hylomorphic model of embodiment. So you have form animating the matter. Also I think Bill talked about Aquinas. Very similar issues here. And the idea is that embodiment is when you have form animating the matter in the correct kind of way. And what you have when you have the hylomorphism of form and matter in us, the appropriate kind, is you have rational animal, which is the human person. Okay, so these are different models of embodiment, six different models. I will quickly end on the idea of whether the kind of constitutive account of embodiment that I sketched will constrain which metaphysical model will be the correct one. Well, the first thing to note is that part of deciding which metaphysical model of embodiment will be the one that you plump for, or which you think is correct, will depend on the metaphysics of self that you prefer, as it were, or the metaphysics of the subject or the person. So if you think that, for example, there are no selves, if you're one of these Dernatians, then you have to go for the no ownership model. And if that's your way of proceeding first, and that's the foundations for where you begin, then you have to rewrite all these different conditions such that it will be able to satisfy something like the no ownership model and yet still retain the idea central to the constitutive account of embodiment. So in a way, what that indicates is that the different metaphysical accounts of embodiment, I think, are slightly orthogonal to this constitutive specification of the best way to characterize the kinds of ways we relate to our body. Because this account that I've given of the constitutive functional account of embodiment tries to capture two things: a functional aspect, causal functional aspect, with also a phenomenological and epistemic aspect. But it does not try to pronounce on what the metaphysics of self must be such that these relations can obtain. I think you can have such an account and yet it leave open what the metaphysics of self would be like. It would certainly set some constraints given other things that one believes, but I think it doesn't uniquely determine which metaphysical model would be the one that one has to go for. And in fact, I think depending on which model you want to go for, you will have to rewrite the conditions such that you can get the appropriate account of embodiment for your preferred metaphysics of the self. Okay, so with that, I end my talk. Let me summarize what I talked about. I raised the questions of embodiment. So the question of embodiment that I wanted to raise in particular was, how does a subject relate to its body? And I focus on the constitutive, phenomenological, and functional aspects of that question. In the beginning, I looked at this functional account from Shoemaker and Foster, which gave two conditions on embodiment: agentive and perceptual embodiment. Argued against it from aspects from the phenomenology of embodiment, which shows that the conditions cannot be truly independent. We then tried to improve on the functional account of embodiment by looking at different varieties of disembodiment, and also possibilities for artificial extension. Once we had that, then we went back and tried to rewrite the functional account of embodiment so that it could capture the agentive, perceptual, affective ownership elements of embodiment. And then we looked finally at how it compared and connected with six different metaphysical models of embodiment. So I want to leave you with a line from Walt Whitman. I sing the body electric, and if the body were not the soul, what is the soul? Thank you.
Great, so we have a good 40 minutes for Q&A.
I'm a little low on money. I want to suggest, it's not a question, it's a comment, a possible research project based on these five aspects. And this is Descartes. Because at the beginning of his life, it's, when he's 20, 25 years old, he says, I'm going to mount the stage. I have been a spectator, now I will be an agent. And 1641, he says in the sixth meditation that I am united with my body in such a way that we form a unity, as you mentioned. Now, so you have a soul and a body constituting something complex. And the evidence seems to be that about 3 years later, he realized he could not make sense of that metaphysics. There is no such compound unity. And what happens is that he says, for example, a little before he dies, I've been doing a lot of work on medicine because I want to live forever. I failed. But I've learned a better way that's more effective, and that's not to care about the body. And he retreats back to looking on his body, the life in the physical world, the way a spectator looks on a fictional play that doesn't much matter. And that's why I've learned not to care about it. So in the sixth meditation, my senses are given to me so that I can preserve the soul-body compound. But in the passions of the soul, a year before he dies, how do the passions help the soul? How do the passions help the body? And I think the two things that Descartes loses are the sense, first of all, the affective sense, the emotional involvement with what's happening in my body. And the second thing is the sense that I am inhabiting a body. Now, I think this suggests a research project. Look at Descartes' writings in the last, let's say, after 1643, the letters to Elizabeth, the passions of the soul, and look for a kind of pathology. A man who has ceased to be embodied in at least two ways. There is still that relation of perception and agency, but no affect and no ownership of the body. So, that's your next book.
Thank you, Sid. Yes, I think Descartes is a unique figure in the history of philosophy and also uniquely marked a kind of turn in how we think about people post-enlightenment. And he tries to go as far as possible with our animality and stop short of you know, mindedness, as it were. So for example, the passions and a lot of things, he allowed explanation in terms of animal aspects of ourselves. So that was incredibly advanced for his time, I think. And one thing we see about the discussion of physicalism and materialism is that that it always looks at the frontiers of science. So for example, in the 19th century, chemistry was thought not to be reducible to physics, and therefore chemistry represented a kind of boundary. And now the frontier is, in a way, consciousness of the mind and things like that. So yeah, we're still saddled with similar problems. And as to the kind of literary psychoanalysis and psychotherapy for Descartes, perhaps that would be a very interesting project. Thank you.
Nelson?
Okay, yeah, thank you, a very interesting talk. This is just a curiosity question. So you talked about like Cogan syndrome and various pathologies that are in the range of the self and the body. And I'm curious like what you think about Capgras syndrome, because in that case, the delusional part is not about your body, but it's just, you know, denying another person, yeah. Your mother is not, yeah. Your father is an imposter, that kind of,
yeah.
Stuff.
Yeah.
So that has definitely some of the same elements. It seems like there's a similar effective mechanism is involved there, and the ownership part is there. You seem to have some kind of ownership relationship with your mother, but some of the other stuff is not definitely there. Yeah, I'm just curious, like, do you think like it's a problem for the embodiment, or do you think our embodiment is extended beyond the body?
Yeah,
the sign that, yeah.
Good, that's a very difficult question. My instincts are very traditional. I'm rather individualist in my method. So a major question is whether the social is some way a condition on how we the individuals we are. That's the logical question. But then related to embodiment, it would be whether these aspects of social cognition are in a way parts of embodiment, individual embodiment, so that social embodiment is part of being individually appropriately embodied. I know some of my colleagues who would say yes. I think I'm not ready to answer that question. Even though I can see why one would say yes to some of these cases, and also conditions under which one would say no, because really it's about how I'm inhabiting this body. You might say this is about the social case is about comportment toward the world in a way. So that there would be a larger sense, not simply of embodiment, but being a subject being embodied in its body, inhabiting the world where it lives. That sounds really handicapping, sorry. Yeah, but that's how someone with those instincts would go.
Eric.
Right, thank you. This question is, it might sound hostile and critical, but it's not, and it's actually meant to be friendly and helpful. Okay, so so you presented a lot of fascinating research about phenomenology and agency and various weird pathologies and so on, and that was great. And then you sort of glossed all of that research or framed it in terms of what I see as two very, very obscure terms, self and body. Now, whenever a philosopher uses the word self or the word body, I usually don't know what they mean. And I don't understand those six models very well at all. And I suspect, and you may know something about what the kind of problem that I have with these terms. And you said nothing whatsoever about what they mean. Yeah. The body or self, okay, or the relative term someone's body. Okay, and my hunch is that all of that interesting stuff about phenomenology and agency and so on can be described without using either the word self or the word body. Okay, I mean, you talk about hands, for example. Hand is okay with me. Okay, no problem with hands.
I thought you did.
I know what the word means. So I guess my question is, why do you lumber all of this important research with these obscure philosophical concepts?
Good. I myself had similar questions a few days ago, because I reread So actually, Eric is one of the people who has written on these issues. Actually, probably the only one who's tried to work out roughly corresponding to this kind of thing what the metaphysics in each case of a sort of a person or what we are connecting with what the sort of body-like object humanoid would be. And I mean, one of the issues is in the metaphysical pictures of embodiment, it already comes with some specification of what the metaphysics of the self is, or an answer to personal ontology. So you try to answer, what am I? And then you may or may not be a thing with the body. And then you try to say what the body is. And then you try to connect the two in some way. Maybe you don't have to connect the two metaphysically. So let's say if you're an animalist, and you think that you are just your body in the sense that you are the animal, then the project that I've sketched will primarily be a project in a way of giving epistemic relations and phenomenological relations between the answer, between the entity, which is what you specified as the answer to what am I, and the other entity on the other side. So that's in a way the abstract answer to your question. If I can give that abstract answer, then that means that there will be the possibility that this set of constitutive conditions could be rewritten for each of these cases, such that I can fill in the slot subject and body with whatever is required in each of these cases, in which case it would make philosophical sense, or as much as the answers to what's a subject and what's a body in each of these views, to the extent that they make sense in each of these views.
So I think what you're saying is that you've got all the tools that would enable you to say what you mean, or give a definition of the word self and the word someone's body.
In each of these
views. That's different ones in different contexts.
That's right, yeah. That doesn't mean that I believe in all these six views, it's just that I think that there are these different views, and if you antecedently plumb for one of these views, for example, then you would write the conditions such that given the appropriate set of constitutive conditions, you would then be giving an account of embodiment. To be very complex, for example, if you have Garvin's view, where you're making yourself, because, well, with these things, it would introduce rather complex conditions, but you can see how it would be done. It's not a metaphysical problem. It's just more conditions, as it were.
I don't object to the word self and body, but I do want to be told what they mean.
Mm-hmm.
And usually people don't say what they mean. And
that's right.
They think I already know what they mean.
Yes, I agree.
Yeah. Okay.
I agree. But I mean, given your complaint, I mean, it would be nice if there would be a way to rewrite these so that they didn't have that kind of issue, as it were. But it's very hard to do that if you are just trying to have a relatively neutral, constitutive account of embodiment. Because, roughly speaking, what's in this slot, what's getting embodied, is the answer to the question, what am I, approximately. And what's in this slot is the particular, or sometimes people don't have a particular. For example, if you believe in substance dualism plus some sort of nihilism about the body, then there wouldn't be a particular on the right hand side. But this will be the humanoid shaped thing that's picked out and that you move and so on.
Is that what it has to mean? I mean, really, it's not clear what these things mean if we're not sure what thing the body is supposed to be.
That's right. So these conditions are, in a way, proxies for things to be filled in within the specific metaphysics. So in a way, you can say that this is a constitutive account which characterizes the epistemic, affective, and phenomenological relations we have to our body, but doesn't yet give the metaphysics of embodiment.
Lucas. So I have two questions. I'm not sure if I'll ask both. So the first one is about proprioception, and is it really necessary for embodiment? Because it would seem if you take proprioception as really essential, then you're going to rule out the walking stick, tools, virtual reality, maybe sensory substitution. And I think sensory substitution, where you have you add a new sense, it's going to be quite important, especially in terms of seeing what's wrong, maybe we should use like Shoemaker. So you know this group at Koblenz, they were making this new, trying to create a new sense of magnetic north. You know this, and they had this bell with vibrators on, with phone vibrators, and they ran it together with kind of phenomenological diaries about what it felt with. And many of the subjects went through this change where to begin with they felt the vibrations, and after a while they just stopped feeling them. Yes. So they'd somehow incorporated this. And I take it there's a real move from perceiving something and then being able to make an inference on the basis of that perception, and in some sense having incorporated this device as a sort of organ. I think that sort of sense of, and I take it like on the perception view, on the view that Shoemaker gives, that if you've got some device that you perceive and then rely and then make inferences about the environment that are reliable, then on his definition, that would seem to be no different from that would become part of your body, which just seems really implausible.
Yes.
So it seems to me this sort of phenomenological thing. And then it turns out once you have this phenomenological incorporation, that the reliability of the people who incorporate and have this don't feel it, don't feel the vibrations, they're the ones who are much better at succeeding in the tasks. But these cases where you've got a sort of feeling of ownership without having the appropriate perception, I guess. So I'm just wondering, if you've got a walking stick, you don't feel the walking stick from the inside, even though you've sort of incorporated it into your body schema and have maybe a feeling of ownership. So I'm just wondering how important you think proprioception is.
Yeah, good. What the question raises is that these conditions at best mark the conditions for normal, healthy human beings without technological extras. And yes, I admit that. And then a further question is whether we should write them in such a way so that they could be a bit more general. You can do that in a way. I think, so one question is whether you could be completely deafferent such that you didn't feel your body at all from the inside.
Mm-hmm.
So based on the question that you were asking to Christina yesterday, mm-hmm. you would imagine something like a Gibsonian agent
mm-hmm.
with just vision and the actual senses, but mm-hmm. using only optic flow information and extraneous yeah. information from the environment in order to determine self-related information. Yeah, I think that's possible.
So the pilot of the drone would have something like that.
Yes, that's okay.
Yeah.
So what I want to say is that these are some central instances. I don't want to rule out those instances. And the other thing I want to say is that in the cases with the walking stick and other extensions and so on and so forth, ultimately the account I want to give is not one in terms of people either being embodied or disembodied.
Mm-hmm.
It's a kind of account where you have claims that you know, you're embodied to the extent to which you can do things. So it involves an element of this notion of being body to a certain degree, and then you could ask what is the criteria there for this degree of embodiment. And it will be some kind of complex criteria having to do with functionality, behavior, and phenomenology of inhabiting that body using these sensory aids and substitutions.
Okay, so I think my question is a replica of Eric's question, my only friend here. So, from the data that you presented, it seems like embodiment is a biological, neurological, and psychological phenomenon, right? And
I don't need to be committed to that, even though I use aspects of those things to motivate it, because primarily the idea is it's a functional relation, and the functional relation can be got at by looking at the emotional side and so on and so forth. So
it is investigated with the methods of biology, neurology, psychology, right?
Those methods give us insight, but I think philosophy also gives us insight, because For example, these disciplines would never articulate constitutive conditions on embodiment.
So why do we need constitutive conditions?
Why do we need constitutive conditions? Because we have lost those.
What is the puzzle that we're trying to solve?
What is the puzzle that we're trying to solve? What is the nature of embodiment? That is the puzzle.
Well, then I'm going to neurologists and then...
No, they only tell me what are the mechanisms underlying embodiment.
So I'm just looking for a verbal definition of embodiment.
No, that's not true, because sometimes I think given the mechanisms can give you insight into the nature of the thing, in which case scientists can be answering constitutive questions too. I mean, there is no question that the brain is involved in cognition. I think we can say that today. But the question still remains to which, you know, neurological substrate and so on and so forth are constitutive on, you know, cognition. I mean, some people deny that. They want to say what cognition is just, you know, appropriate computational relations.
So when I'm saying it's constitutive of cognition, what have I added to my understanding of the world? I mean, it's constitutive for me to understand, said it. What have I learned?
You've just realized that gives the articulation of the nature of the thing. That's what you've learned.
So, but then if you accept that the brain is involved in cognition, then we shouldn't bother with the many metaphysical models like Descartes' model, right? So some models are already out, right? So we have to forget about some of them that are not relevant anymore.
Sure, yes. So in a way, I'm willing to say that, but I didn't want to get into metaphysical disputes about physicalism and cells and so on and so forth. So if you think that the best way to proceed is first by characterizing in a relatively metaphysics-free way these different relations based on trying to write up the functional conditions, once you have that, if you think that some of this is implemented in the brain and that the brain is doing important things, then some pictures naturally drop out of the story. Not because we have any deductive argument against substance dualism. I think there is no strong deductive argument against substance dualism, but because the weight of evidence just doesn't give us any kind of inclination in order to see substance dualism as providing a powerful model. So in a way, you're right. Once I buy into this stuff, then a lot of the models that I put up, the six metaphysical models, just drop by the wayside. But I want my investigation to be useful for metaphysicians too, and they often proceed from the opposite direction. They establish first what am I, and then what is my body, and then they want to ask how do they relate. So someone like John Foster, if he were to come back from the grave, I mean, since he's an immaterial soul, he's not really in the grave. So that's, let's say, according to Darwin. So John Foster, he would be able to then take my constitutive conditions and add it to his immaterial self, second edition.
Nice.
Charlotte?
Yes, I have a question about the artificial
involvement
and
the rubber hand
is that.
Yeah,
okay. I was wondering, because we perceive the hand as being ours, and I suppose we have proprioception, if we were to stop our own real hand from moving, and we hit the rubber hand, would we perceive fake, or react as if we were fake?
Sorry, I missed the last part. Well, possibly. You definitely. So what that shows is that there's definitely a trap response. And what's important for this case is not simply that there is an absolute trap response. So in doing this experiment, what you have to measure in order to show that you actually have a difference in the case where you embody the rubber hand versus the case where you don't embody the rubber hand is that you have to have the experiment under two conditions. So you have a synchronous condition like the one which was shown here, and under this synchronous condition where the rubber hand is simultaneously stroked with your biological hand, which is out of view, then you have a sense of ownership over that hand.
Now there's a control condition, which is where they're asynchronously stored. In that condition, you don't get a sense of ownership over the hand. Now the thing with the threat is that anytime you have a threat, you will have a threat response. If you see someone being threatened, you have a threat response as well, physiologically. So it's important for measuring a threat response that you look at the difference between the synchronous condition as opposed to the asynchronous condition. And if there's a significance between those two conditions, then you can say that the threat response is a measure of the degree of embodiment there. And typically, experimental findings indicate that the degree of the threat response is very well correlated with the degree to which people agree that the rubber hand is theirs. Okay, so you have a subjective measure, which is the questionnaire report, and that's correlated with the objective measure in terms of the threat response.
Great. There's a finger?
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure that you knew that I was in the queue.
Sorry.
I just wanted to make sure that you knew that I was in the queue.
Okay, you're in the queue. Okay. Sorry.
Okay, I just wanted to ask what one can get the implications out of observing this elastic model of sense of body ownership? It seems like it's elastic, it can change. So what does it tell us in terms of sensory inputs or this power dynamics in this sensory inputs?
Yeah, so it raises very complex and interesting questions about the mechanisms underlying this, because as you pointed out there, it's a very plastic kind of representation, as it were. You can apply it to hands, you can apply it to avatars, and so on and so forth. And the only conditions you appear to need is that you have a handshake object in front of you, and that you have certain kinds of multi-sensory integration based on synchronous stimulation. I think the plasticity, on the one hand, it's very plastic, but on the other hand, when you look at the cases where people get disembodied in various ways, the pathologies, it's very hard to treat some of these pathologies. So in cases of somatic paraphernalia, typically people spontaneously recover after stroke and so on and so forth. So on the one hand, you have this ease of embodying a rubber hand, but on the other hand, if you look at the pathologies of disembodiment, they're not that easy to treat often. I mean, one interesting fact is that this I think is really really cool. You wouldn't think that this is possible. So one of my colleagues in London, Katerina Fitopoulou, has pioneered a therapy for somatoparaphernalia, and it's very surprising. So when you show the patient her hand in a mirror, and you instruct her to look at her hand in the mirror, then she says that it's her hand. But when you take away the mirror, and they're looking at their hand from a normal first-person perspective, and say it's not their hand. And this apparently is quite effective as a mode of therapy for sort of reintegrating the hand. So again, it's very plastic, but it's also very odd, because you have this kind of switch of perspective, and then you get a switch of ownership. The very low-tech switch of perspective, just mirror.
So what would be the message of observing this?
What would be the message of observing this? Well, I think body representations are very plastic and malleable, but they are central to us having the lives that we have as material beings, which can identify ourselves as the same kinds of things over different things and over different times and places. And it has to have enough plasticity so that it has the functionality that we can do what we can do normally. But when the body representations come under threat, the plasticity may or may not go in a way such that that therapy is easy, and the plasticity is such that we can incorporate many, many objects and other modes of existence, so you can easily incorporate like extra hands and try to, you know, for example, people say that driving a car is in a way embodying the car. I think that's a little bit too plastic,
But there are certain aspects in which you then, you know, these London bus drivers, or bus drivers anywhere, basically, who have these big buses, they seem to know the dimensions of the vehicle quite well, so that they can navigate with a 20-centimeter difference. And so that means that they must have some kind of implicit representation which is guiding action.
Okay, so this is an assembly of the question, but it's really the hostile the first
one. I know everyone here is really nice, so no question is not taken as well.
So something that was worrying me about the Shoemaker definition, but I think it's also a worry about something that you add, is putting veridical perception into the conditions for development. So a worry is that if you think, as a lot of people think, that perceptual content has an index climate. So what are we saying when we say for veridical perception? We're saying things like, well, I see that the coffee cup is in front of me, or when the coffee cup is in front of me, I see that the coffee cup is in front of me. Or yeah. When I see that the coffee cup is here, the coffee cup is here. Okay. And you might also think this is true for proprioception. When something happens to my body, I feel that something's going on in my body. So it looks as though when you spell out what it is to have veridical perceptual experience, you're already presupposing that you know which body is your body. Now, I assume this isn't a problem for your characterization of the point, but I can't see why it's not a problem, because it looks as though there's a risk of introducing some kind of circularity.
Yeah, good, thanks. So, in response to the circularity, I want to say that there is a circularity, but it's not vicious.
Okay.
That's the first thing. And the second thing I want to say is that the original way which Shoemaker had for dealing with the kinds of issues that we raise was to formulate his specifications in terms of the volitional theory of action, namely the triumph theory, and the causal theory of perception out of Christ. So there's a kind of matching sensory impressions and so on and so forth. So even if the lexical content is a match, you have, you know, the representational content of the other aspects matching in a way. And notice that the characterization is in terms of there is this clause. It's a subject is sensorially embodied in a certain body to the extent that so that's managed. That's supposed to capture kind of those issues in a way, because you don't want to say that if somebody constantly has, you know, illusions or hallucinations, they're completely disembodied. It's just that they are, you know, they're less embodied sensorially.
How do you handle it for proprioception, though?
Proprioception,
it's
yeah.
That's gonna...
yeah, good. So in the proprioceptive case, I take it that, so here we get into some issues to do with what counts as your body. And there are two characterizations at least. One is your body is, well, more than two. So there are the following characterizations. There's the biological one. There's a matter of fact about, you know, which body is yours. Namely the one that your animal has. That's it. That might be controversial, but it comes with the controversy of having that view. Now there's another one which is in terms of index for access. So your body is whichever body you have that kind of indexical access to. In which case, you know, even if you are rewired, it will be the case that that's your body insofar as you have indexical access to that. And another view would be one which combines the biological view, where there's a matter of a fact, or some view where it involves independent specification of the fact based on biology or using agency, what you can move as a criterion for what counts as a word, and checking the indexical access element against that. So even if you are rewired such that you have indexical access to some other bodies because you can't move them away, they're not your body. So there will be ways to characterize the what comes as your body in different ways. But there is an issue there because there is a philosophical question about what counts as your body, which is the answer.
Christian?
So I was wondering whether you can make justice for one of the paradigmatic cases of disembodiment, which is virtual reality. And interestingly, I have this problem with the same things, namely veridicality, but from completely different directions. So when there is an out-of-body illusion, then some says that you disembody your body and embody the other body. So I think it's a wrong description with Bingham Legenhauer, but we just bracket that. So you have to explain the embodying the other body, disembodying your body. The funny thing is the following. You can explain the disembodying your body, but you have no resource to explain the embodying the other body, because you, and probably that might be not good enough for me, so I make an immersive virtual reality environment. So they are working on that. It will be about 5 years. So the immersive virtual reality environment. No, the immersive is when all of the senses, like olfactory, every senses are virtual. So there is no sense which would be computing information which is veridical. Nothing is veridical, like zero. All the experiments show any sense, and it would be internal too. So the internal senses will be.
It doesn't show that it's not veridical, it just shows that it's virtual.
Okay. Yes,
there's a further question whether the virtual is veridical or non-veridical.
Yeah, but then we imagine a case where nothing veridical. Mm-hmm. I can't add. But then, so nothing veridical, but you will still embody the virtual reality avatar, but there will be nothing veridical. And because nothing veridical, according to your things, which is you embody to the extent and blah blah, whatever, and veridical perception, then you will have no account for the embodying the avatar. And there is the further problem that nobody ever showed that we disembodied our body when we have the VR, and even in that immersive case, it's not clear that there is disembodying, but your account can only explain the disembodying, which might be not the case, but cannot explain the embodying, which is definitely the case.
Okay, good, thanks. I will have to write more conditions so that I can capture those cases. And actually, what you say allows me to answer Eric's question.
Okay.
And the question that also Sally asked, which is that in these cases, you might say you embody two different bodies to different extents. So your own body you embody to a large extent. Maybe you suffer from a slight degree of disembodiment relative to the comparison between the normal case and when you go into immersive virtual reality environment, because some of your resources are set to embodying the virtual body in the virtual environment. Now, that doesn't mean that you're disembodied from the first body, it just means that maybe you are a little bit less embodied, or that it's quite possible that given these virtual reality cases that you can have multiple bodies. And I think that raises very, very difficult philosophical questions, and which explains why we get constitutions of the part. Because the scientists will never tell us what is the case. They can only tell us a limit on the number of bodies that you can embody. So in Tübingen at the Max Planck Institute, they've tried to do the full body illusion with two bodies rather than one. So you see two bodies being shot. And it's very difficult to interpret what happens in those cases, because there are limits on how many bodies you can embody. But imagine you have no such problems. Then you are in the kind of scenario that Strawson sketched in Individual. So Strawson imagined, actually, Strawson criticized Descartes, saying that one body. There's nothing particularly important or special about one body. Rather, you could be, agentially embodied in this body, perceptually embodied in that body, effectively embodied in yet another body, and then, it just happens that in the normal case, it all coincides. Now, question, does the unity, in a way, the material unity have an importance? I think it does, because the material unity is what, in a way, gets everything together and allows for the representational unity. But given that you have mechanisms involved which are plastic, as was pointed out, it is possible to play with these mechanisms such that under some conditions you could be said to be embodying more than one body.
This would probably be the last question.
Yeah. Actually, very short question, Pascal.
Yeah,
okay. Three questions, one is neutral, one is hostile, and one is friendly. So, would you like to have first?
Try to prioritize maybe.
You call your approach non-reductive, but I really couldn't understand what do you say that it is non-reductive. It is functional, but it is neurofunctional, and it is very, very similar to, I believe, it is my opinion, that Metzinger's position, and Metzinger says that self is just a myth, but what he gives as example is exactly the same examples with you, all through the, his book, for example.
So what I meant by non-reductive was not the overall metaphysics of the self. So I think, I'm not sure whether Thomas Metzinger is an eliminativist or reductionist about the self, but he's either eliminativist or reductionist.
Yeah.
And I wasn't commenting on that. The non-reductive element I was commenting on had to do with whether the conditions are specified independently. So in Shoemaker's account, the specification of the agency and the perception conditions, they simply exhaust the nature of embodiment. Whereas my conditions are intertwined because the ownership condition already specifies awareness of a certain body that will constrain the agency and experience conditions. It's in that sense that it's non-reductive. I also happen to be a non-reductive physicalist, so I would have to disagree with Metzinger there about those things, but I don't think that was the focus here.
Okay, question. I just want to learn that whether you can reach the following question from these examples. Many people who can declare themselves as neurophilosophers or something like that, empirically informed philosophers of mind, would conclude that these examples also show that introspection and insight and intuition are not reliable tools to have the truth. So, do you think that they are right? Because if they are right, I believe that analytical philosophy, there are huge consequences, bad consequences for analytical philosophy as a whole.
That's a huge question.
I know.
So I can simply assert my prejudices. I believe that philosophy is a very plastic and malleable subject that treats as its subject matter whatever is the most exciting subject matter currently available for us for reflection, and uses the widest possible spectrum of methods which are available for generalists like philosophers to reflect on the phenomena. It may involve experiment, it may involve motor intuitions, it may involve all kinds of things. And the point is that in the end you have to reach some sort of reflective equilibrium. But that kind of equilibrium can be reached in many ways, and philosophy allows for many possibilities. I think it's important here to allow a thousand flowers to bloom.
Thank you.
Unfortunately, we are out of time, so let's thank our speaker.